ورحمة الله. Welcome back to the Abu Dhabi International Book Fair. My name is Saeed. I'm an arts and culture journalist from the national newspaper here in Abu Dhabi. And today we are privileged to share the stage with Ali Tabrizi, the director of Seaspiracy, a groundbreaking and at times shocking documentary that laid bare some of the hard truths that the fishing industry's effect that it has on our marine life and our overall environment. The film is powerful, it's riveting and exciting as Ali and team travel the world to expose the devastating impact of fish consumption. This is a film that we really can't ignore, and here is the trailer. Yeah. Miriam, we can just play the trailer? Fantastic.
My name is Ali. I've been fascinated with the ocean for as long as I can remember. But this romantic vision that I always had of the ocean completely changed. I was forced to confront a side of the story I never knew. A story of just how huge our impact on the seas had become.
Where are the big environment groups? They are deliberately not engaging with the most important issue of all.
Can you turn off the cameras? Thanks.
Would you say there's any safety concerns for me making this film?
The safety concerns are serious. Ignore them at your risk.
If you're getting in the way of their business, you are risking your own life.
The slaughter of these dolphins is a reaction to the overfishing that's happening.
We hear a lot about blood diamonds. This is blood shrimp.
We are at war with the oceans, and if we win this war, we're going to lose it all because mankind is not able to live on this planet with the Dead Sea.
I just don't see how you could possibly enforce sustainable fishing laws with all these boats.
The same syndicates that are behind illegal fishing are the same criminal groups that are behind drug trafficking, human trafficking, and other crimes.
So there's no slavery going on?
No.
Isn't it?
If you want to address climate change, the first thing you do is protect the ocean. And the solution to that is very simple. Leave it alone.
Most of the positive and negative things that bring about change in human civilization start with someone. Someone.
Wow. Ali, welcome back. So welcome to Abu Dhabi. Before here, you were in South Korea in Seoul speaking about the film. It's been 2 years now since the film came out, and you have been traveling and you have been talking about it. And what has been so far your reaction to the way this film has been received, and why has it touched a nerve so quickly?
In many ways, I feel humbly that Seaspiracy as a documentary broke through the cultural barriers which kind of separated people who are into traditional movies and people who are into documentaries. There was something about Seaspiracy that made, you know, A-list celebrities in Hollywood share it on their Instagrams. We had Hugh Jackman, we had Kardashians, we had, Sir Paul McCartney from the Beatles sharing it, and then the Facebook page of the Beatles with 40 million followers was sharing it. So there was something about it. Now, of course, it was released on the back end of the pandemic. We didn't have a physical premiere, but so many people were at home watching Netflix, and that definitely propelled it into the eyes of many millions of people that would have maybe not taken a chance on a documentary. So I think that played a factor. But beyond that, I think people at the end of the day are hungry for truth. There's something within us that wants to know what's really happening in the world that we live in. And also documentaries in particular, they have a special quality, especially in this kind of guerrilla style, which feels like it's going up against the high seats of power that are pulling the wool over our eyes. And that's really kind of what we set out to do, is to make a movie unlike other traditional ocean films, which are all pretty images of dolphins with slow motion, you know, and classical music playing. Isn't the ocean wonderful? And it is wonderful, but it's dying. And so when we started to realize the ocean was dying, you know, and I came to terms with this personally. I knew that I wanted to make a film on it. So I think that's what really did it.
What I found interesting about the film is that it shed light not only on the challenges facing the ocean, but also the general fishing industry. Now, these are topics that I don't really hear discussed enough when it comes to discussions about conservation, environmentalism. I mean, I feel like it's a blind spot. And that's why I thought, wow, I found it very revelatory, this film. Do you feel that it is a blind spot?
Absolutely. I mean, if I was to do a general poll right now and ask, you know, what would you say is the leading threat to the ocean? I think most people would say things like, you know, plastic straws or climate change or, you know, maybe even wildlife poaching, not realizing that the fishing industry is the single greatest destroyer of wildlife on Earth. So most people have a picture of, someone with a gun shooting a rhino as a form of wildlife poaching. The fishing industry is wildlife poaching on a mass scale that's commercialized, because fish is wildlife.
So can you just even break that down further? Yeah. For example, okay, so how can you make a practical example?
Of course.
Of fish consumption affecting, you know, the ocean life, mm-hmm. affecting the overall environment. Is there a direct, clear line?
Absolutely. So we can cover this right now. So most of us have heard of the whaling industry, where for over 100 years, 200 years, many hundreds of years, there was an international, I believe it was one of the first international trades, was whaling and whale products. The lamps that used to light the streets of London were lit with the oil of whales. So it was a big industry. Before plastics, we were using whale bones. It was a big thing. And these were ships with the sole intention of going out there and killing as many whales as they could. Now, if we look at 100 years of whaling from 1900 to the year 2000, and we look at how many whales were killed, it's approximately 3 million. The fishing industry kills the same number of dolphins and whales in just 10 years by accident. They're not even trying to kill them. They're that effective at killing whales. We're losing up to 30,000 sharks every hour from the fishing industry, along with 5 million fish every single minute. So imagine, as this talk continues, minute by minute goes, I want you to imagine 5 million fish piling up. It would fill this room in a matter of minutes. This is a major cause of the species extinction which we're facing right now, which is unfolding in the eyes of a single generation. And by far, the oceans are the most neglected environmental issue. And then more so from that, the biggest threat to the ocean is an even bigger blind spot. People don't talk about the fishing industry.
Is the blind spot caused by the fact that, you know, we take our oceans and even our fishes for granted? Like, it's just always been there. Yeah. We can see a polar ice cape melt. We can see things melting. We can see things, you know, volcanoes blowing up.
Yeah, these are visceral things.
Above the surface. But fish, the ocean has always been there. You think that's kind of part of the reason why we never really gave it, you know, the attention it deserves?
Yeah, culturally, I think we view the fishing industry as this rather kind of a romantic job, you know, going out to sea, catching a few fish. In the UK, where I'm from, we have a lot of adverts on the TV of a little jolly fisherman with a red hat going out and catching some fish. Whereas the reality of it is that today, the industrial fishing operations are operating like cartels, that are operating like criminal syndicates, that are going out there, and when it comes to the high seas, there's a tremendous amount of illegal fishing that's going on. I speak for myself, like, I just didn't even think the fishing industry was much of a threat. And when you look beneath the waves of what's really going on, when you see a fishing vessel floating on the surface, you can sometimes have these fishing nets that are so huge, they can fit 13 jumbo jet aircrafts inside the net. They're that big, and that's what they're collecting.
And also, the film shows that how it's in kind of that the wastage is interlinked, because you show that how fishing consumption and the way we catch fish also contributes to plastic waste. That is something perhaps, you know, I thought there were like different silos, different forms of waste not linked to each other. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
So I mentioned plastic straws earlier, and I think, I don't know if you've seen it here in Abu Dhabi much, but in England, it seems like you can't go anywhere now and buy a plastic straw.
Same thing here now, that's happening.
It's become so culturally seen as a symbol of everything that's against the environment. But what we found during the making of this was that only 0.03% of all the plastic entering the sea each year were plastic straws. It's really, as much as we shouldn't be using plastic straws, it's really kind of a non-issue in the big grand scheme of things. The argument has been that it's like a gateway drug into caring about the environment. Let's just start caring about straws and maybe it'll lead somewhere else. My argument has always been that maybe we should be looking at the bigger picture.
Do you think there's a bit of symbolism sometimes? We use the straw thing. I mean, yes, it's very, very well intentioned, but do you think sometimes, you know, it can kind of be used, well, you know, we're doing that, is very, you know, it's an easy win?
Yeah. Well, how many people here noticed that when you go to a Starbucks and you get one of those plastic iced coffee things, they'll give you a paper straw? Right. And it's like, well, the whole thing is kind of plastic. Like, this is the least amount of plastic that you're swapping out for paper. And it's kind of, for me, it becomes a little bit of a gimmick. So when we start looking at the contribution of fishing gear as a major source of plastic pollution, plastic waste entering the sea, it's phenomenal. So some data shows that on European beaches, where we're about 40% of the plastic is coming from the fishing industry. When it comes to the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, in the Pacific Ocean, there's a huge floating gyre of plastic. And a fact came out after the film that showed that it was far worse than what we put in it, but roughly 85% of the plastic in the Pacific Ocean is from fishing gear. Now remember, this is plastic waste that's designed to kill a whale, designed to kill a fish. It entangles these creatures. So it's the type of plastic is also far more dangerous as well.
And there's a part of the film that you're going to show us a clip of that showcases the effect.
Absolutely,
of that plastic waste.
Now would be a good time to show that, I believe, yeah.
If you can show the second video, please.
Even the groups that are talking about marine plastic are highly reluctant to talk about what
sounds not working
is, which is fishing nets and fishing. Even the groups that are talking about marine plastic are highly
reluctant
to
turn up the sound.
Talk about what a lot of that plastic is, which is fishing nets and fishing gear, which we hear a lot about the Great Pacific.
We may need to replay the clip and turn the audio up.
Cotton buds and plastic bags are swirling around in the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. 46% of it. Even the groups that are talking about marine plastic are highly reluctant to talk about what a lot of that plastic is, which is fishing nets and fishing gear, which we hear a lot about the Great Pacific Garbage Patch and say, oh, isn't it terrible? All our cotton buds and plastic bags are swirling around in the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. 46% of it is fishing nets, discarded fishing nets, which are far more dangerous for marine life than our plastic straws, because, of course, they're designed to kill. Now, this is so crashingly obvious. Why aren't we talking about it? Why aren't even the plastics campaigns talking about fishing?
How had I not heard about this before? Fishing vessels discard a massive amount of ropes and lines, and this was a major problem. Today, even some of the most remote places on Earth were awash with fishing gear, like Henderson Island in the Pacific Ocean, and Svalbard in the Arctic Circle. In fact, looking closer at some of the whales that washed up in the UK when my journey began, I discovered fishing gear was the main trash in their stomachs. This was the whale in the room that no one was talking about. I even found that longline fishing sets enough fishing lines to wrap around the entire planet 500 times every single day.
Although there isn't a
Yeah. So, and you saw the fact there that it said 46%. Like I said, it's we new data has found it's actually 85% of the plastic trash in the Pacific Garbage Patch.
I mean, even just we'll delve into this more. One of the narrative devices, the way that you your narration is that it's almost like you're discovering things as well as the viewer. Is you're not coming from a perspective. You're not coming from a perspective of, I know this already, this is what I know. You're actually showing that you are part of that discovery process. How important was that for you?
Yeah, it was critical, because it's something that I appreciate when I watch a movie or I read a story. And on top of that, it was what was really happening. So as the journey was progressing, as we were finding ourselves in different countries around the world trying to find out what was going on, it was literally finding a little thread and I was pulling at it, and then before I knew it, I was going down the rabbit hole, and there was just more and more things. So, and I also think that made the movie a little bit more accessible to audiences who are used to getting browbeaten by environmentalists saying, you should do this. Whereas my ethos has always been, this isn't about trying to shame people, it's not about immediate perfection, but it's about the clarity that truth can bring to solving very real world problems.
Absolutely. And now let's kind of like, you know, let me draw a longer thread to kind of go back to a little bit, about yourself. Just tell us a little bit about, you know, your childhood and really what awakened, what's the first instances that awakened your concern about the environment?
Yeah. It was, honestly, I think watching a lot of nature programs with my dad as a kid that helped me have a little bit more of an eco-consciousness going on. So whether that be watching, you know, wildcats on the African savannah, or watching, I don't know if you watched it here years ago, but Steve Irwin, the crocodile guy, and just starting to become familiar with wildlife. And in the UK, you know, a big icon of television is David Attenborough.
Yep.
And watching a lot of the ocean shows just really inspired me. And I always grew up by the ocean in England. And I was always confused by the fact that when I was watching the TV shows, there was incredible colorful fish and incredible whales and coral reefs. But where I lived, there was just nothing there. It was just kind of murky green water with no life in it. And so I was kind of envious or aspirational that one day I'd get to see this life for myself. One day I'd be able to film this stuff. And when it came time, when I was in my early 20s, I realized, like, actually a lot has changed. A lot has changed in the ocean, and it's no longer this bountiful place, but it's on life support. And that's why the film had to focus on that, to bring a sense of justice to what was really going on.
When it comes to filmmaking also as well, I read that you almost kind of taught yourself how to make films. You didn't kind of go to an established or even tried to go to a film school or something like that?
Yeah, that's right. So as we were making this movie, which I can't believe someone took the risk on me to do, to be honest, because I think I was only 21 when I started this. I had no background in film, but I knew how to operate cameras. That was my passion, even from a kid. I was filming stuff and learning as I was going on, and even whilst the editing of this movie was taking place and I was editing it, I was having to watch YouTube tutorials to teach me how to edit things. It was a very, very independent film, and people don't really get that when they watch the movie because they think it's a big Netflix production. And honestly, I think the budget for this film was probably smaller than the catering budgets of most movies. It was done so small. But to be honest, I believe that worked for us because we were able to slip through the cracks where other bigger film productions couldn't get through, whether that be in Japan, where we have 12 police cars following us and we can look like we're just a tourist couple filming some stuff, or slipping in between the streets of Hong Kong, filming the wildlife traders, or getting on board a fishing vessel.
It's almost like Indiana Jones meets Richard.
Yeah, I like that. Yeah, it felt very much like that. It felt like we were breaking rules every step of the way, and we couldn't believe we got away with it most of the time.
But I do feel, in a way, quote unquote, the lack of technical knowledge that you had in making film worked for you. I mean, I think what made this film really, crossed over to others is that it has a really kind of kinetic energy. You are employing guerrilla style like tactics to shooting. It's almost like war footage, the way that you kind of, or journalistic footage, in terms of how you kind of cracking in. I mean, was that? I mean, how much of that was by necessity, or artistic direction?
That's a very good observation. So for me, before I decided that I really wanted to focus on the environment stuff, I knew that I wanted to use filmmaking and photography as a way of sort of telling stories. I was never a great writer, unfortunately, but cameras were my way of telling a story. And when I was 15, I had this a little bit of a goal that I wanted to actually become a war photographer. So it's kind of a strange thing for a 15-year-old to say, but I always wanted to go to, you know, Palestine or other areas where there was areas of conflict and go there and share those stories. So I was inspired a lot by war photojournalists at the time. And that kind of, I think, influenced my taste and maybe my style a little bit. So I think that's what you might have seen come across. I like the grittiness.
You know, I mean, talking about some of the, I mean, the grittiness of the film. I mean, what makes the film stand out, I mean, for me anyway, was, I mean, there's a lot of like stark footage. Like you, the camera doesn't shy away from showing the destructive effects. You know, there's dead fishes, there's beached whales. And this is a lot of the times, you know, we don't see that, you know, even in the most good-natured documentaries. Now, I wonder, and because, so there's that aspect, and the other aspect is that, you know, you're very passionate about what you do. You wear your heart on your sleeve. I mean, there's a message that you want to see. How tough is it to take those footage? Particularly, there's a part of the film, a quite distressing part of the film, where you're showing the effects of whaling in the Faroe Islands. It's a very, very tough watch. How was it for you to film that, you know, as a professional person, a person being behind the camera? Was it quite emotional and quite, I guess, psychologically damaging in a way?
It was, but it's interesting because I think human beings have an amazing way of compartmentalizing their experiences and repressing, which I don't believe is a healthy thing to do necessarily, but I found myself doing that as an automatic response. So when I was in the Faroe Islands and I was witnessing 150 huge whales being slaughtered in front of me and I'm wading in their blood and I'm filming what's going on, I went into shutdown. I went to, okay, I've got a job to do. I'll never experience this in my life and people have to see this. I just went into a bit of a robot mode. Okay, so I just started just filming and not thinking about it too much. Whereas my co-director, Lucy, who, by the way, is now my wife. We never intended that way, but we became my wife. She had the opposite reaction. She was actually more emotional about it, and she was more in touch with it. And so on one hand, she was very in touch with it, and I wasn't. And it was interesting how we were dealing with things differently. But that's really what happened. But overall, I really feel that as storytellers, whether that be in literary formats or film or music or whatever that may be, I do feel a sense of responsibility to share things that are happening in the world today, which can be improved through the sharing of truth in order to set the foundation for a more loving world. And one of the things that sort of has bugged me about the film industry in particular is the insane billions of dollars going into action movies and pure entertainment and escapism, which is great, but how little goes into sharing stuff about the real world. And what's amazing to me is how little this kind of footage is actually being shown. When you look at the facts about the number of animals that we're killing on a daily basis for something as trivial as a sandwich, it's incredible.
Why are we more comfortable showing dead people getting blown up in action films and not dead fishes and dead animals?
Yeah, because I think on one level we know that it's fake, and on the other hand we're not emotionally invested in the killing of human beings, like more so than we are the emotional investment in having our favorite KFC or our favorite tuna sandwich. And you know, if you look at the rate that we're killing fish, it's something like 2.7 trillion fish every year. And when we look at livestock, you're looking at like 80 billion, something like that, a year in just a couple of countries alone. Now, if we look at how fast we're killing other species, if human beings tried to kill other human beings at the same rate, human beings would be extinct in about 3 days. So you just think about the death machine that's been set up to create this and how little we see it every day.
Getting this kind of footage, you know, would be perhaps dangerous, because I kind of felt, well, how did he get here? You know, can you tell us a bit, you know, I mean, first of all, was there some dangerous moments shooting this film? Or by dangerous, I mean physical or kind of, you know, legally?
Yeah.
You know, like, were there some legal gray areas?
Well, maybe we can touch on the legal stuff in a moment.
Yeah.
But there were definitely hairy moments during the making of Seaspiracy. I think one of the main ones that sticks out to me was whilst trying to film the stories of ex-slaves, meaning people who have escaped slavery working on fishing vessels, we went over to Thailand. We managed to track down three individuals who had escaped, and we wanted to interview them. Now, bear in mind, in Thailand, they do not want this kind of story getting out, and we didn't exactly have, shall we say, the right permissions to be filming in that country, and that alone would have probably landed us in prison. Nonetheless, through naivety or whatever you may call it, we went for it and we started emailing around trying to find a translator. And our email got through to someone who were like, oh yeah, we can help you, but there's someone at the Thai government that can help you. So they forward all of our emails with why we're in the country, what we're doing, what hotel we're staying at, when we're... They had all of our information. And at that point, we were sweating bullets because we were like, the police could show up any moment and shut us down. So we decided either we had to leave the country right then or we had to film this right away and then get out. We chose the second option.
Because, you know, you are traveling around the world taking all this footage. You know, you're gathering. One lead leads to another. You go on the plane to the next place. So you're gathering all this information, all of this footage. At what stage of the process did you realize, okay, I have a film here. I have something, you know, now I have something. Was there a moment? Was there a particular a scene? Or was it just a growing feeling that, hey, this is going to be interesting?
It was a snowball effect. It was gaining momentum as we were doing it. So, really from day one, I knew I was onto something because when I started to go down this rabbit hole and pull on this thread, the information I was finding out was so mind-blowing to me that when I then started to tell some people in my life about the stuff, they just couldn't believe it either. And their reaction was so strong. And I knew that if I was to get this story filmed in the right way and capture the right kind of footage and just show it to people, it was going to make a big splash. And so really from day one, the kind of information that we had was proving that. And I think we have a video clip if you wanted to show that aspect of it. We can.
Do you want to introduce what this video is about?
Yeah, so this is just a short video clip from the movie. It's actually not really the most extreme fact, but it's something that is pretty early on in the movie that shows just how much we're destroying wildlife in our oceans when it just comes to sharks alone. And I already mentioned the fact earlier, but this is why the quality and the power of filmmaking comes across, because I can tell you this fact, but then you watching it right now, it'll stick in your head more because of animation and stuff. So let's just watch that. That video.
If we can play the next video, please.
Around the world, on average, sharks kill about...
We've got to turn it up, though.
Now, comparatively speaking, we kill 11,000 to 30,000 sharks per hour. The crazy thing is, almost half of those sharks killed are killed as bycatch from commercial fishing fleets, and they're discarded as waste back into the ocean.
Bycatch was all the other marine life caught while trying to catch a target species. And I was shocked to learn that every year, at least 50 million sharks are caught in nets this way, side by side with our favorite seafood. Studies estimate that up to 40% of all marine life caught gets thrown right back overboard as bycatch, and most of them die before they even hit the water.
So stopping shark fin soup is only half the picture. The problem is that eating fish is just as bad, if not worse, than the shark finning industry, because the shark finning industry is strictly held in Asia, whereas everyone around the world is eating fish.
I refer to bycatch as the invisible victims of the fishing industry. The industry will call bycatch accidental take, but there's nothing accidental about bycatch. It's factored into the economics of fishing.
In those fisheries where we have a better understanding of bycatch, the numbers can be alarming. And so to give you one example, in Iceland, in a one-month fishery, that fishery caught 269 harbor porpoises, something like 900 seals of four different species, and 5,000 seabirds. And that's just one little fishery in one little part of Iceland. Taken across the world's oceans, the amount of bycatch is huge.
The people need to realize that when you're shooting this film, the idea of Netflix wasn't even in your head.
That's right. Yeah.
So this was purely a passion-driven project. Before Netflix came into the picture, and we'll ask that after this, I mean, what was your plan? Just going to shoot this film, all this work, and just pop it up on YouTube? What was your distribution idea?
That was it. Yeah, pretty much. So, you know, like I said, we had a very small budget. And in my mind, this was just a film that I was kind of making for myself. But, like, I might have uploaded somewhere. Obviously, we wanted it to be seen. But, like, what started this journey was really that I was trying to learn for myself what was happening to the ocean, just to educate myself. I was curious. And I was finding there really wasn't many movies about this. And so I really kind of set out to make the movie that I wanted to see.
Was it a blessing to kind of shoot it that way without knowing that, you know, a big platform will come?
I think so.
For your artistic integrity and...
Yeah. I'm a little bit of a perfectionist and I put a lot of pressure on myself to do well. And I think if I heard that Netflix was going to buy it from day one, I probably would have just... I don't know what I would have done. But, you know, we were about 2.5 years into the project before we heard Netflix were interested.
How did they get into the picture?
So... There's a production company in America called AUM Films that had made a movie called Cowspiracy many years earlier about the livestock industry.
Right.
Okay. And I reached out to them, or they reached out to me, and we started talking. I said, I want to make a movie about the ocean. Would you produce it? They said yes, and we had a very, very small budget to cover flights and meals and some cameras. And that's kind of how we started it.
How big was the team?
AUM Films is... One person.
I mean, your production crew, when
My
you're
production,
flying.
Two people.
Wow.
So the whole movie of Seaspiracy, minus we had some animators and some musicians and stuff like that we outsourced as freelancing, but the entire movie was filmed by myself and Lucy, who's now my wife, editing it, color grading it, producing it, getting airline tickets to the country, you know, everything.
So... Netflix were looking for some material.
Yeah, that's right. So they reached out to the American production company and said, hey, like, you know, your last film was great. Like, what are you working on now? And I think the Kip, who's the guy that runs that, he's like, oh, well, you know, we've got this kid who's making some ocean film, but, you know, and they're like, okay, let us have a look. And then they had a look at what I'd made so far and they were like, we need that to be a Netflix original. And so that's when the pressure was on to complete it. It took us another 2 years to finish it. But, you know, once it released, it was like one of the top 10 trending movies in about 50 countries around the world.
So tell us about that. So yeah. That day, because I remember when that film came out, because I remember I'm working, you know, in the paper and then Seaspiracy is trending every 2 minutes.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, I'll just deal with that later.
Yeah.
And then it kept trending again.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, this is a thing. You know, we have to discuss this in the paper because, you know, we cover film and all that. You know, and I remember all this traffic, all this conversation in social media, in the general media. Just tell us, take us back to that first day.
That's right.
That it arrived on Netflix, it premiered.
Yeah.
Was the reception, was the reaction immediate? Like, when did you first started seeing messages or social media? Is it, how long after?
It was immediate. So Netflix has a tremendous amount of viewers. And basically, we only finished the movie probably about a week before it aired because I was just doing final touches and final...
The perfectionist in you.
Yeah. So it was like right to the bone. And it released, and then I think within the first 24 hours, it was trending on Twitter. News outlets from around the world, you know, everywhere from, you know, London, New York, India, you know, New Delhi, just everywhere were doing articles on it. And... you know, news articles that, not just one, like I think one news outlet in the UK, The Independent, did something like 12 articles on it. The Guardian were doing multiple, BBC, New York Times, Vogue, The Financial Times, Forbes, everyone.
What were they remarking on? Like, in terms of the initial reaction, was it the shock factor of
It was the shock factor. It was this controversial film is a must watch. It was, you know, what you didn't know about the ocean. It was what celebrities are talking about. It was just every headline you can imagine. It was just exploding everywhere. We had our Instagram account, I think, grew by like 100,000 followers like every 2 days or something crazy like that. It was just everywhere. And obviously the celebrities piling on top.
Yeah, let's talk about the celebrity the film, as great as it is, the celebrity endorsement were important. I mean, can you tell us a little bit about, you know, who came, like who endorsed it? I mean, you alluded to this earlier, and what effect that it had in terms of...
Well, I mean, like when you look at like someone like Hugh Jackman, you know, Wolverine, or, you know, the actor that played in The Greatest Showman, you know, he had a video of himself walking down like busy New York streets doing multiple videos. So everyone keeps telling me about Seaspiracy, you know, I've got to watch it. And he was promoting it to his audience, and it just seemed like everyone was piling on top. And what it did was it brought all of their followers to watch Seaspiracy, you know, these accounts with like 30 million followers.
And also as well, I mean, the nod from Paul McCartney, who is as famous as well, you know, as his environmentalism.
Sure.
That must have also added not just celebrity, but the legitimacy as well.
Yeah, it was massive. It was massive, especially for the UK. But the thing is, I say all this not to say, isn't it great that these celebrities promoted my film? It was more that, like, I hope that by sharing some of the humble beginnings of this film, it can inspire people to some degree to think that, like, you don't need to have, like, all these qualifications before you can do something. You don't need to, you know, get permission from executives. You don't need to work your way up for, like, 20 years until you're in a place where you can do it. We had such a gusto attitude of, like, you know, effort kind of thing. We're going to choose ourselves. We're going to go out there and do it and sort of not worry about the risks too much. And so that's what really kind of... That's why I say that, because we got the you couldn't buy the marketing, you know, and PR that we were getting, but it was all from an organic, authentic place.
Also, I mean, there's those responses, and then don't forget the responses from the fishing industry, responses from those companies, and they were fierce. I mean, they weren't going to just let you slide going in there. Doing all so, can you tell us a little bit about the about those responses? And was there a concerted effort to kind of delegitimize the film?
Absolutely. So we were a big threat to the fishing industry, which is a massive global industry worth tens, hundreds of billions of dollars. And I think as the show was rising up the ranks of Netflix, and as it felt like quite literally every news outlet and TV show and Good Morning Breakfast show was talking about the movie, they upped their efforts to double down and attack the movie. And
not surprising, right?
Not surprisingly. And we were kind of okay with that. And we were getting threats of being sued by fishing companies from Asia. We showed a clip of their fishing boat and they were saying, hey, you accused us of illegally fishing. We never did that. And we said, well, here you go. Here's all the evidence that proves your vessel did. And then they just backed off. We had so much evidence that they really couldn't touch us in the end. But one of the strongest was the Scottish salmon farming industry that were coming after us for a long, long time, making up lies about us and really trying to threat to sue us, because the salmon farming industry is like one of the biggest growing industries on earth today. Something like 50% of all the fish that we eat today is coming from fish farms. And it's a very lucrative industry. So they were one of the biggest threats. They perceived us as one of their biggest threats. And so they went really hard at us, yeah.
And just, we'll just have a couple more questions before we throw it out to the audience. So please, we will have some time for questions and answers. So think about those questions that you want to ask. I mean, talking about also responses, what about the fish eaters? Okay, people consume fish, right? What is the message? Is it simply to cut it down out of your life, don't eat fish, or is there a message of consume with moderation?
Sure.
So, because in one hand, this is the thing sometimes with environmental films, that it has if it's not done in a nuanced way, it could kind of alienate the people that you really want to reach. Sure. So what is your message to them?
Well, my message really is that we ought to shift to a more plant-based diet.
Plant-based diet.
And now what that looks like for you might be entirely unique. It might be, you might start with one meal a week, you might do a few days a week, you might do several weeks a month, until you might get familiar with it. It's one of the best decisions I've ever made, and it's a delicious thing to do, to consume plant-based foods, and I think it's one of the greatest things that we can do to align with our values. You know, so many of us say we love animals, but at the same time, we pay someone else to kill animals so that we can eat their bodies. And I think if we want to live more in harmony with our values, more in harmony with compassion, I think it's just a great way to live. But, you know, it just comes down to how we approach this personally. And after the release of the movie, we saw so many hundreds of thousands of people reach out to us saying that they were moving that way. But look, I'll pose it like this, because it can be a daunting prospect. But in the last sort of 50 years, we've lost 90% of all the world's large fish, just gone. And the percentage of loss is very similar to the medium and small size fish as well. What if we were talking about the Amazon rainforest? What if we had lost 90% of the Amazonian rainforest and all the wildlife? What would you propose that we do? Should we sustainably cut down the last 10% of forest? Or should we leave the last 10% of forest alone and let it recover, realizing that we've taken too much and it's now time to stop? This is exactly the same analogy that applies to the ocean. We have taken far too much fish for far too long, and what I propose is that we ought to step back and leave the ocean be so that it can recover.
When it comes, yeah, absolutely. When it comes to the response now to that, we are in the Abu Dhabi International Book Fair. The key theme of the book fair is sustainability. This is in line with the UAE government declaring that this is the year of sustainability. After that, we have COP28 coming to Dubai in November 30. Is it encouraging that you are able to have these discussions in a book fair, in a cultural space, and at the same time having this discussion being done within UAE policymakers and on top of level by world leaders? Are you seeing some welcome action in this field?
Absolutely. And there's been a definite shift of cultural attitudes when it comes to discussing sustainability and the environment. It seems like everyone's now caring about it and talking about it, which is incredible and great. And I'd like to see that continue. However, the devil is in the detail. Okay, so we can talk about sustainability until we're blue in the face, but unless we have a clear definition of what sustainability even means, we may as well just go home and just do nothing. And that's one of the running themes in Seaspiracy. We kept on asking officials and people that were leading up NGOs about what does sustainable fishing even mean? And no one could give us a simple answer, which is shocking because that is the narrative when it comes to how to protect the ocean. It's the narrative that the United Nations is peddling about how to save the ocean. Sustainable fishing. What does it even mean? And so the definitions are incredibly important. Another analogy is, over the last couple of years, the UN declared the next 10 years as the ocean decade, and one of the big campaigns from governments has been to back the sort of mission to protect 30% of the ocean by 2030. 30 by 30. You'll see it in all kinds of government websites, people taking steps to protect their waters. Protect it from what? If we're going to have a policy that protects 30% of the ocean that doesn't mention the fishing industry, then what are we doing? The fishing industry is the primary threat to the ocean. So what I would like to see at COP28 and more things like that is that we get really specific about what we mean. Because when we don't spell it out, it leaves massive loopholes that we can avoid accountability down the line. It kind of talks a good game. It's a lot of greenwashing, unfortunately. And what I would like to see is, wouldn't it be amazing for Abu Dhabi to lead the way with ocean conservation and say, this is exactly what we're going to do, and this is what it means. And that's what I would love to see over the next few years. Some clarity and some decisive action about what's really happening. Real protection from the real threats.
Absolutely. And now we have a roving microphone around. Does anybody want to... we have a question over here in the front. We've got about 5-6 minutes, so yeah, it works.
Assalamualaikum. Welcome. How are you?
Good, thank you.
I have like a bunch of questions, but...
The
most important question that I have... Sorry. Most important question that I have is about the individual effort versus the fish mafia, I will call it that, the fish mafia and the governmental organizations. Because I know like Slavoj Žižek, he's a philosopher, and he talks about like Starbucks and you know the fake coffee that is being sustainable, blah, blah, forever. And how that is not really up to us. You know, like when you talked about the straws, and you said is it 0.00. Okay, we could all stop using straws, but Starbucks has not stopped using plastic cups. Nor has McDonald's stopped using.
So what can we do, like on an individual?
What can we do? Why should we do it?
Like, because, got you. Yeah.
It's a great
because
question.
Because we're a small people.
Yeah.
And we can say, okay, everybody in this room is going to go vegan.
Sure.
But will that stop the fish industry?
Yeah, so it's a really great question. So one of our calls to, we have three calls to action as Seaspiracy. Stop, defund, protect. One of those applies to people, me and you. The rest of the two apply to government. So stop means we need to stop consuming all this stuff because at the end of the day, the fishing industry is going out there for supply and demand issues. Like if we stop demanding the products, what are they going to do? They just can't catch fish and just throw it in the trash. The other two are government focused. Defund. That means every year the world governments are giving about $35 billion to the fishing industry to keep it afloat because it's just losing profit. Less and less fish in the ocean, higher and higher fuel costs, okay, and higher demand. So without the subsidies, the fishing industry, many if not most of the vessels on the high seas especially, they just wouldn't be profitable. So that's where governments can take action, and protect is obviously protect at least 30% of the ocean from industrial fishing. Just have some sanctuary. But don't forget, the reason why Starbucks and all these companies have started to use at least some more sustainable stuff has been from the NGO pressure, which ultimately comes from the people pressure. If we're operating in a sort of more free market sense of supply and demand, then money speaks. So I think it's worth noting that we do have a choice. And when you do become vegan or plant-based most of the time, all of the time, which would be amazing, you're having tangible effects. You are.
We have a question to this gentleman over here. It's coming right behind you, sir.
Thank you. I was recently out on the ocean off the coast of West Africa, and there are a lot of ghost shipping fleets that aren't even have their AIS on. So basically, it's that automatic system that tells you there. And one night, we were in a situation where we were trying to get a boat to change course, and they refused to. We latterly found out the reason they didn't want to change course is because they were a fishing trawler, and they had nets going for like 2 or 3 miles. So the question I'd ask is, if these guys are operating with no AIS, no identification, and illegally fishing probably, how are they stopped?
Yeah, fantastic question. West Africa is like a hot zone for all of this stuff that's going on. Fortunately, the organizations like Sea Shepherd who are out there are doing amazing work to stop this stuff. But you're right, how do you stop this? You need the political will to be able to go out there with policing vessels, essentially, to go out there and stop it. And that's what Sea Shepherd have kind of done with the Liberian government and Ivory Coast government to, basically, they don't have the funds for the ship, so they provide the ship, they provide the volunteers, and they just give them some coast guards with the authority to do this stuff. But the switching off of the transponders and all that, that's a big problem. Because what do you do when you're trying to regulate this fishing industry, but you can't even see where they're operating? What do you do? Oh, I'm just going to do a little name drop here. A few days ago, I was actually briefly hanging out with Al Gore, believe it or not. And apparently he's involved with an organization, I forget the name of it, Mind Trace or something like that, which is using data from satellite imagery and AI to help track fishing vessels, not only by the light emissions from space, but also the CO2 emissions, weird things like that to try and trace these vessels. So I'm kind of hopeful that stuff like that, new technology is going to help. But man, the big problem seems to be just the lack of political will to enforce law within the jurisdiction of countries. But because it's in the ocean, oh, it's just fish. Now, bear in mind, these fishing vessels aren't just moving around fish. They're using fish to money launder drugs trafficking, weapons trafficking. There's a huge amount of like prostitution happening in fishing ports and stuff like that. This is a major human rights violation. And this is how gangs and criminal cartels and syndicates are kind of getting away with it. Fishing vessels look cute. They don't look like a threat. So we need more action on these areas, West Africa, East Africa. Gosh, there's so much to do there.
And we have room for one more question before we wrap up the session.
Hello, my name is Sylvia. Thank you so very much. I felt miserable. As the ladies here, it is really truth terrible. I just wanted to ask you to address a question. How can I distinguish, from an anthropological point of view, all the millions of people that survive on fishing? I'm thinking on Southeast Asia, there are millions of people also in Mexico, etc., but they live on that. Okay, so it's, of course, impractical to imagine that they can shift just easily to another industry, of course. So when you are talking, so I understand that you are touching something which is, something extreme, very complicated issues. And you are talking about cartel, so that's very explicit. And I do understand that, what we are meaning of with that. So how can you distinguish the real life of fishermen, that they, of course, they live for their family, their villages, and also the industry, of course. How do you distinguish this anthropological necessity, which is a profession of millions of people, and the fact that this is a value for each of us, and to destroy that, and destroy us anyway, human communities? Yeah. How can you distinguish that? Right. Can you distinguish that?
Yeah, I think my distinction would be if you can eat something else, then I would say go for it. If you can't, and to be honest, most people that can't aren't listening to me speak in Abu Dhabi or watching Netflix, because they're, you know, there might be a canoe fisherman, artisan fisherman in West Africa. There's a really poignant scene in the movie where we're out at sea and we're filming these illegal fishing vessels in West Africa, and two men in a canoe go up to the fishing vessel, go up to the vessel we're on, and start begging for food because these vessels have taken their fish. So what I always say, because this has been one of the arguments about, well, you can't just tell people not, to not eat fish. The primary way that we can help those indigenous communities who rely on fish to keep their sustenance up is for us not to eat their fish. Many years ago, there was, I believe it was a Norwegian fishing fleet that went up the entire west coast of India, and it took so many fish that it put something like a million small fishermen out of work. Like a million small fishermen out of work because of just a handful of Norwegian fishing fleets. So that's what is happening in West Africa. You've got Chinese and European fishing fleets taking the fish from those rural communities that rely on it and selling it for cheap in Europe or Asia, or worse, taking those fish, grinding it up and feeding it to the farmed fish as a luxury product that we then sell. Now, what's even worse is that those communities who can no longer take those fish from the sea to sustain themselves are finding themselves going out into the jungle and hunting bushmeat, which was one of the contributing factors to the Ebola epidemic many years ago. It was that they were having more contact with zoonotic diseases because they weren't eating the fish anymore. It's a complicated thing, but my primary thing is, if you're watching this and you're seeing our message on Instagram, if you've got an iPhone, if you've got a flat screen TV, if you're here listening today, chances are you're probably not in a survival situation where you need to do that for sustenance, and that would be my barometer, I guess. Great question, though.
And Seaspiracy is available, continues to be available on Netflix. Ali Tabrizi, thank you so much for coming
to Abu Dhabi International Book Fair.
And thank you very much for coming down and listening to this really important conversation. And may you have a wonderful weekend. The book fair continues.